It's not on?
It's fine.
Yes, it's on. I don't pay much attention to the microphone because I've got a big mouth. But I'm very pleased to welcome you here this evening to our continued celebration through the year of the legacy of George Washington Harper and his commitment to academic and intellectual excellence and the university's commitment to access and opportunity. Tonight we have the privilege of hearing from one of America's outstanding artists, poet, and essayist, playwright, Mari Evans. I had the privilege of meeting Mari Evans more years ago than I guess either one of us cared to know. We worked together in California, in South Carolina, in Indiana, and now in Iowa. I have seen her interact with people from all backgrounds, at all stations of life, in a way that speaks to the integrity and dignity and respect of every human. Her poetry reflects her own commitment to justice and social change, and opening new perspectives on the human experience. Dr. Evans has been honored by colleges and universities across the country with appointments as well as awards, and she has written a number of works. Most recently, her volume, A Dark and Splendid Mass, which is available on the table in the back, several books of children's rhymes, as well as her recent rendition or transformation of Zora Neale Hurston's novel, Their Eyes Were Watching God, into a musical and drama entitled Eyes, which has been performed in a number of cities across the nation. This afternoon in my class, she informed us that a number of artists have set some of her poetry to music, has been performed in a number of places. There will soon be a CD out with the Proud Symphony performing her songs. In a variety of places, people have found her to be a welcome and refreshing voice in this nation. And it is my privilege to present to you a friend, a colleague, and an outstanding artist.
James Baldwin, who is, can you hear me? Okay. James Baldwin, who is one of our finest essayists, of course, who was one of our finest essayists, said that the responsibility of the writer is to reveal all that he or she can possibly discover about the mystery of the human being. And of course, that's a challenge to those of us who write, and I know that you are writing, that you probably write and put things away on pieces of paper and don't share them with people, but you're writing. And so I think that's what we try to do, reveal all that we possibly can discover about the human being. The nice thing about being a black writer is, one of the nice things, is that we live our theater. We don't have to invent anything. We don't have to look for subjects. the drama is 24/7. And so you write what you feel and who you are and what you observe, and that's what I have tried to do. The pieces that I write are with very few exceptions, and I guess when I find an exception, I may share that with you and say, this is an exception. But normally, they are about real people, about real concerns, certainly real concerns, real issues. And I rely on that to bring some ring of authenticity to the work. The poet, a long time ago, I used to say that the poet begins to write when he or she first moves in pursuit of himself or herself. The initial impetus to search stems from the poet's understanding, however vague, that the nooks and crannies of his being do not belong to him. Like a curious child fingering an anthill, she pokes and examines, inspecting her finds and announcing them as major discoveries. We really want to know who we are more than anything else, I think. That's our first move. Unlike the child, however, the poet records both her search and her findings, understanding that the search is personal, specific, and unique. But the journey is every person's journey. Who am I is no naive, esoteric query. It's a basic, urgent inquiry that demands an answer. I have never been contained, except I made the prison, nor known a chain, except those forged by me. Oh, I am slave, and I am master, am at once both bound and free. I am a wisp of energy flung from the core of the universe, housed in a temple of flesh and bones and blood. In the temple, because it is there that I make my home. Free of the temple, not bound by the temple, but housed. No distances, I am everywhere. Energy and will of the universe expressed, realizing my oneness, my indivisibility, I am the one force, I. And of course we've all felt hemmed in, surrounded, encompassed, beleaguered. This is called Untitled Number 2. Flatted faces rim my vacuum, crystal prison for my chaos, for my yearning hands, my hair. If there be sorrow, let it be for things undone, undreamed, unrealized, unattained. To these add one, love, withheld, restrained. I think for a lot of us that are parents, that particularly rings true. You love a child dearly and wonder why you restrain and withhold. And you really don't understand yourself, so there's some more searching to be done. I know with pain the me that is, and I inbreathe this anguish deep upon my heart. I keen and flail behind my tight-squeezed lids, much too aware to stay, and seemingly unable to depart. I'm going to have to take the bracelets off. because they keep knocking, and I like them, but I think you'd probably rather not hear them. The next sound that you hear will be my glasses in my hand instead of on my eyes. I can no longer sing the fluid beauty which once fled my soul to hang quicksilvered in the moat-filled air has gone. Stripped is my heart, joy lies discarded near, and I am naked in my silence. That's happened to us, I think, more times than we are willing to deal with. And then this one, I think most of us can react to. I was not really left behind. My face, my eyes, part of my smile remained, it's true, but oh, the substance of me, yes, the warmth and love of me, the clinging softness of me, all the yielding went with you. And this, because I was an observer once, when a dear friend, I went with a dear friend to the hospital to visit her mother. And, you know, we always have friends that don't seem to get it. Her mother was seriously ill. And I could hear one side, I could hear the discourse, a one-sided thing, and how we go down the long path singly, mewling pain, the shriveled flesh, the sharpened knee to lonely chest. How do you feel, Mama? You're looking fine, Mama. We go, you feel like singing, Mama? Down the long path. Oh, I went to the rock to hide my face. The rock cried out, no hiding place. We go singly. And in our ongoing confusion, I don't know if we ever stop being truly confused. I think there is a level of confusion that remains with us for a long time. This is entitled Search. Fog blind, pain directed, nerve ends raw and contact bruised. One wanders through the life mist, hands outstretched. See the heart as canvas, touched with brush, inscribed with pen. The heart is marble slab, a sail, a chisel unrelenting. See the heart as pulse, as bloodstream, bruised and panting, mean to live, resolute, undaunted, steeled, in spite of, yes, to live. There are some people pieces that come from watching the drama in the lives of people around us, and also in seeing the angst sometimes of hearing the language that is unspoken. She came down to get him. Came after the patron re-entered and shot him. She came down sharply, serrated edge concealed, her Sunday hat and good black suit, no camouflage at all. They heard her with their eyes, the men she always said would kill him, and in their hostile circle, wept one final time with loving, never knowing if they touched her, wilting cold inside her casing, taking home her satin casket of, I told you so, I told you. And we hear a lot, those of us who are female, about the various weaknesses and flaws and problems and whatnot of the men in our lives and the men that we see around us, and we know they're a pretty bad bunch. But this is entitled, "There Are Men Who Grow Like Trees." There are men who grow like trees, strong and dark, from the ground, rooted. Men whose chins rise at an angle, up. Whose eyes are fearless, straight ahead. Whose smiles approach broadly, open. Men whose arms are promises, dark branches, intimate and warm, tender. There are men who grow like trees. This is entitled Street Lady, in the colloquial sense. And this is also true, this one about the men is also true, but this was a newspaper item. I think the young lady was about 19. When she stabbed him, it was not the folded leather, not the bilious wrinkled bills, her quick eye vaulting sidewise, nor remembered odors, alien and pressing. When she stabbed him, it was not his face, huge with hurting, hunting, not his knotted anger, cradle pink, cradle pink. When she stabbed him, it was merely that his time was suddenly and clearly hers, and she, the instrument, arm poised to end with certain grace, and in the instant of her choice, his reign. This is entitled On the Death of Gucci by Starvation. They rubbed the roots, genuflected generously, burned 7 red candles 7 hours a day for 7 days. He learned the tyranny of hunger in a basement where gray granite went. They whirled the cup, studied grounds, anointed palms with sweet red oil, and danced with ecstasy. Terrified of mice, Starvation stole his breath and drank what had been laughter. They folded names, sprinkled salt, sewed white cat claws in satin bags, and crooned the songs. He died alone, 6 years of bone, broken tender, a hungry anguish. They in white, brown faces framed in satin, indifferent footsteps soft above the lonely crypt, folded names, rubbed the roots, and sprinkled salt. They genuflect each other. You've seen these ladies, or you've known these ladies. It's entitled Ladies Waiting in the Mall. They refuse to know the name, these parchment ladies, no longer striding in some social arrogance, secure in gown and guarded graciousness. They refuse to know the name, or recognize those faces once so grandly patronized. These powdered cafe au lait ladies, quiet now and shrinking from the sear, the public scrutiny of age, revealed in pore and line and pouch, in the relentless obscene now of thinning wave and nylon curl. Preferring not to know a name, these once tall ladies, groomed and slightly fragrant, slightly frayed, wait in the glitz and the aimlessness, and she had been failing shopping malls for transport. Gone the grandeur once so carefully contrived, the firm and fragile flesh, the haughty stride, the unrelenting judgment, the clear demanding eye, all that remains, a head averted slightly, and a ragged clutch of pride. This is another kind of lady. It's entitled Perfume in the Mind. The extra chair, she sets it there. And there, the extra cups, the spoons, she shines each time she lays them. Dusts the chair each week for next. And stands for moments pleased with gleaming spoons and fragile cups and polished chair. Before she locks the outer door, turns off the lights and moves upstairs to certain gloom, but perfume in the mind, and rocks sometimes, and sometimes nods alone. In the 60s, we were in search of ourselves, and we were trying to communicate concepts that we'd never quite flaunted before. And this is a poem that masquerades as nothing but humor, when really it's about concepts. It's entitled When in Rome, and some of you may have seen it in anthologies and that kind of thing. It's written in, well, it's not an idiom, but at any rate, you will understand there are two speakers. Mattie dear, the box is full, take whatever you like to eat. An egg or soups ain't no meat. There's endive there and cottage cheese. If I had some black-eyed peas. There's sardines on the shelves and such. Don't get my anchovies, they cost too much. Me get the anchovies indeed. What she thinks she got, a bird? There's plenty in there to fill you up. Mm-hmm. Just the sights enough. Hope I live till I get home. I'm tired of eating what they eat in Rome. And of course you understood. That was about choices. And different kinds of value systems. Not better, not worse, just different. This is entitled 725 Trolley. At the time I wrote this, there actually were trolleys. I keep it in there because that's the way it was written. Because I need the word for the rhythm too. Ain't got time for bite to eat. I'll have to run to catch my trolley at the end of the block, and if I take my coffee there, she looks at the cup, she looks at the clock, sure hope I don't mess my car. My house looks like a hurricane. If I did what I ought to do, I'd stay at home today. I can't eat no hurricane. Broke as I am, I need what you'll pay. Hope I just don't mess my car. Wish my life was a life of ease, maid, cook, and butler, running at my beck and call. I may scrub floors, but I don't get on my knees, and someday I won't go at all. Sure hope I don't miss my car. I came out of the sky back in 85. I had a couple bad experiences. And in my community, you don't try for three. So I thought I had more time than I had lives. And Now I travel Amtrak sometimes. I'll have to get over that crash last week before I get back on Amtrak. Or Greyhound, which also gets you there. I have a few poems that came from the Amtrak experience. And I was thinking today, airplanes don't inspire you to write poetry. They make you think, because you can't help but think when you look out at the clouds and you're on top of. You do start to wonder. One of my constant thoughts while I was in the air was suddenly to realize that here I was in the air, sitting in a chair going 600 miles an hour, and somehow that didn't seem normal. But on the train inspires you to write. You really, there are all kinds of things. You just grab papers and, you know, go at it. This is entitled Respect. People stand at attention for passing trains, following with their eyes a cortege of the dead or of the rich and famous. All over the country, this slow motion salute, arms folded, at rest. Red nylon jackets, blue sleeved, rain-streaked bicycles, handlebars restrained at the rise of a small hill, or admitted to another day's gray tedium, freeze-framed in backlit doorways, or once again refused to face another night's despair, at rest and bleak. They stand, the road a welt of brush, the train a disappearing challenge, cold metaphor for races run but never won. People stand at attention all over the country for passing trains. This one, part of an Amtrak suite, a subtitle, Passing a Penitentiary in Full Flight. The train in flying gear rocks past a flat red prison complex, urged beyond its passions, its performances to flee. The elongated fingers straining at escaping windows. Forced to race in futile contest it will neither place nor win, with stark and fleshless dreams, in swift and shifting pursuit, with chill imaginings and opaque eyeballs prying through the clouded thermal panes. See the train in flight, it speeds the bedrock past untidy undergrowth, and past the ragged stands of pine. Red brick walls cannot contain the narrow, barren lives. They have no baggage and are faster than the whine of late November wind. They lie in wait within the cages, nails unsheathed and hunger honed, a mass, undisciplined and eager, passage subsidized, their destination of no real import, for there is anywhere but here. The instinct, the insatiate goal, the pure intent to ride at that train each time, each time, each time, each time, each time. This one, subtitled Weak Orange Sunlight on Deserted Ruins. There's some gorgeous panoramic views that fill your spirit when you're on the train. Moments, gorgeous moments, many of them. It speeds her on to where no one is waiting, where no hand will sweep the curtain to one side, nor lift the shade a bit to peer beneath, nor crack the door, to tilt the head out and inquire of the street. The train is in control of time and situation. Woman in a corner watching trees rush backwards, caught in some relentless forward motion, her reluctance no concern at all. It speeds her on this train, that gives so little and imposes much, it speeds her on to where no hand will sweep the curtain to one side, nor lift the shade, nor tilt the head out to inquire of the street if she is near or anywhere. There are the things you see, and this one, how many men remain in Beckley? Beckley is a town in West Virginia, and it's one of the places you go past, and the train slows or stops long enough for you to read some of the signs, and the train is not going that fast anyhow. You can usually read any sign. And there was a sign that had to do with the readjustment, an offer to readjustment to veterans. And I thought, how many men remain? How many veterans are there now in Beckley? What special group needs readjustment, and from what to what? How many spirits seared and sucking still on secrets smuggled back from Anzio, from Nam, Korea, Lebanon, Grenada, Haiti, Desert Storm, South Central? What readjustment can there be from flux and mayhem? Certainly a severed arm, blasted into bloody isolation from the face, the foot, the ankle bone demands a new perspective, must require some getting used to. Is there now some caution that the Beckley vets are home and see DuPont, shag noble-like and white in Beckley fog? Is there now some caution that the Beckley vets are home and armed, debriefed, but not defused? That some may be quite clear about the rules of war, that privilege and power are the tools of war, and they, the patriotic pawns, the wistful fools of war, and thus demystified, just might identify the source and site of war and wage their further combat here. Who decides which special group needs readjustment? And this one, entitled Good Assassination, should be quiet. He had a dream exploded down his throat, whereon a million hard white eyes swung impiously heavenward to mourn the gross indelicate demise. Such public death transgresses all known rules. A good assassination should be quiet and occupy the heart 400 years. And this one, entitled Tune for Two Fingers, ain't it a shame, ain't it a shame, the free I don't can't pop the fingers in. The free in freedom was put there to blow your mind and blow your game. Ain't it a shame, ain't it a shame, the free in freedom was put there to blow your mind and blow your game. While we were thinking of changing the world, making it safe for humanity, one of the things we thought about was the way we educate our children. And we felt that no child who doesn't know about himself is truly free. And this is entitled A Schoolhouse. They built a schoolhouse where the children could come to be taught the calabash, the ono leaf, and mountain water sparkling the compound. And they sat around it with guns, for it was a jewel, casting brilliances into the future. They sat around it with guns, for it was a jewel. This is Alabama landscape. The piece that Dr. Blake referred to that has just been recorded by the Prague Czechoslovakia Symphony. Dr. David Baker, who is a professor of jazz, heads the jazz department at Bloomington, Indiana, Indiana University, set the piece, and Paul Freeman, renowned African-American symphonic conductor, went to Prague, as did, I forgot the brother who was a tenor, who went, Bill Brown, the tenor, went to sing the piece. And I dedicated it to all of the black victims of police action lynchings throughout the United States, and especially for a 17-year-old youngster named Michael Taylor, who, and I use the word committed suicide in quotes, committed suicide by shooting himself in the temple while sitting in the back seat of an Indianapolis squad car, while his hands were steel cuffed behind him. Well, it was justifiable. I won't say justifiable. It was suicide. The FBI, everybody finally confirmed that it was suicide. Okay, this is segment one. But this, and this part of what happens when I travel by Amtrak, and as I mentioned, travel through the South, where the undergrowth is so incredibly mean-looking, it seems to me. I can't do that without, we're part of everything that is past, and therefore when I go through the South on Amtrak and look out at the undergrowth, I'm not going to work or going, I never go on vacation, but I'm not going to work. I am one with the escaping black person who is running down those hills through that underbrush, headed heaven knows where. He certainly doesn't know where, nor does she. They have no compass, they have no map, they have no information about the territory further down. So, when you think of the courage it took to just break free, see the ancient underbrush, the disciplined entanglement, wild welt of trees and gullies, traps of mud and broken branch, the hairline brook, the secret water, see the stirring, see him coming, modulating through the silence, leaping sinkholes, torn confusion, buckling knees, then grace regained. He ducks and dodges, black man running, claiming freedom. Through the ageless sun and shadow, vanishes from sight. He is at once past and present, history repeated, history relearned, history relived, the present savagely contrived, the past still swollen, still unhealed, and all transition merely language. What was tar and rope and flame was rape and scourge is magnum now, is unrelenting chokehold. Sanctioned lynching still orgasmic. The time is surely near when we reluctantly have learned what lessons time intends to teach. And such intransigence as now is veiled and hid, we will release, when for their 1,000 blows return 1,010. However unannounced the truth is clear, the murders of oppression still, the unabated war we seem unable to define goes on. Black man running through the ageless sun and shadow, vulnerable, still unavenged, History repeated past all logic. Who is it buys the time and why? And for how long? There will be no one left for Owens. One of the things we did during the 60s, it was nothing we learned as part of the continuum of who we knew we had been, was to honor our elders. And this is entitled The Nonagenarian. His hand itself the autumn leaf, and he and his November, dried and sucking from the sun a chilly heat, the whispery winds blow quiet odors past his teeth, a package, used and battered, old and brown, he makes his way about the town, a superior compassion. And this one, entitled Elders. With their bad feet and their gray hair and amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Cardboard fans with a colored family, seasonal gift from Baker's funeral home. Stirring heat and hallelujahs. No hiding place down here, son. I asked Jesus to change your name, child. Help me, Jesus, through one more day. And yes, ma'am, I don't mind working late again. And no, sir, I'm feeling fine. It'd be a long time before you need a younger man to work this job. And swing low, sweet chariot, Lord, somewhere there's a crown for me. Be our heritage, our strength. The way they moved from can to can't, preparing the way, throwing down the road. Say, want you to have more than I had, child. Say, be more than I am. Go. Go where there ain't no limits. See you standing at the top of that mountain, looking down. With their bad feet and their gray hair, bony symbols of indomitable will, having triumphed over gory, endured the middle passage, survived cotton and cane, branding iron and bullwhip, crossed Deep River into Canaan, strode through Dust Bowl and Depression, smiled through smoking Watts and knew its smoldering Detroit, and locked old arms with young to sing, surely we shall overcome, and now be seeing walk together, children. We went through the undergrowth with only cane knives, and we cut it down to size. Fight the fight, wage the wars, and when it's in your blood. With their bad feet and their gray hair, they be our heritage, our strength. Torn tins pitched at the foot of the mountain, having moved from can to can't, they be our national treasure. They be our priceless charge. There'll be two or three more, and because my concern is children, my ongoing concern, I don't know how many of you know or have heard the name Paula Cooper, but Paula is a young woman who at 15 killed a young black woman who at 15 killed a white Sunday school teacher by stabbing her to death. You, some of you are nodding your head. I think you've read of the case. When I first saw the publicity on Paula and was appalled, it was a heinous crime, and one can't imagine how a child can get to that. Well, at that point, one couldn't imagine how a child could get to that point. But it seems that the teacher had befriended Paula and some of her friends. And after school, they'd go to her home And she would give them small treats and talk to them about Sunday school. And this particular occasion, they went to her home, asked for some money. She said she didn't have any money to give them. And as she turned to go to the telephone, someone struck her from behind, and Paula stabbed her 31 times. At one point, the knife even went through her body into the floor. Well, when my spirit could deal with the notion of Paula, with the thought of contacting this girl who had done this terrible deed, I wrote her, because I thought that here is a 15-year-old whose crime is certainly one of the worst I've ever heard. She needs someone other than prison officials to relate to. Maybe I can help, maybe I can be a friend. And when I thought I could honestly approach her, I wrote and said, if you need a friend, I'll be happy. And she wrote back. That began one of many visits that I made to the prison to talk to Paula. At the time, I was working at Spelman College in Atlanta, where the creme de la creme of the national black community sends the children who come there. Are the creme de la creme, I suppose, in terms of privilege and background and intelligence, because the school rejects 2/3 of all of its applicants. I said to Paula, Paula, you're every bit as bright as any of the students I have at Spelman. To which she replied, I didn't know I was this smart until I got here, meaning women's prison at 15. Somewhere in that case, we, all of us, are implicated. Lies the reach, the blind potential, all that lingers in the breathing is a warp of understanding, a fist of clear confusion, and a desperate, a frightened need to live. You would probably be interested to know that in Indiana, at one time, I was on the governor's commission to write the penal code, and for about 10 years, I worked as an advocate for prisoners. But in Indiana, there, at the time we were doing the code, there were about 3 psychologists employed by the state for the entire state. These 3 serviced all of the prison facilities. And 1 psychiatrist. So you know that the young people or anybody who offends and who commits the grisly murders, these people are not getting help. And at this point, I'm reasonably sure Paula could count the number of visits she may have had with the psychiatrist. They'd be sporadic. It wouldn't be ongoing, weekly, that kind of thing. So we have a young 15-year-old in 89 and whatever, I haven't done the arithmetic, what she is now, I guess in her early 20s or whatever. At one point, I asked Paula, rather I said in the very beginning, I'm a writer, I'd like to write your story, but that's not, my friendship isn't contingent on whether or not you say yes. She said no, she didn't want it written. So we became friends anyhow. And I felt it was quite clear what had happened to Paula, but Paula could never deal with it. And at one time she said she changed her mind and it was all right if I wrote her story. So the prison changed my designation from visitor to, from friend to journalist. And now I could take in paper and pen and I could tape. And I did that, and after a while, Paula was very unhappy with me, and she said, you're wanting me to deal with stuff I put behind me. I would say, Paula, you can't put it behind you until you deal with it. And this is a young lady who gets fan mail, and more fans, she stays busy answering fan mail. But in terms of whether or not she's had any treatment, I put my last cent on the fact that she hasn't. Nothing that will be substantive and useful. And I guess the real point is that she's not alone. You know, one psychiatrist for the whole state. And a situation where inmates dispense medicine. This is another.
What time do we have? 9:15. Okay.
Can you have about another 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. This is eulogy for a child whose parents prayed of love. Someone said they had difficulty with the word prayed, and of course that means who say things you don't completely mean. Listen to his song, this child, this singer without voice, this solitary figure on the barren plain of life, a dislocation rife with chlorophyll for one last melancholy spring. Listen to his voice, this singer without tongue, without significant thrust or timbre, disconnected. He has met the threshing winds, unclosed, full-faced, with no sure understanding. If some protective sun could just embrace him, he would live. This is entitled Mother's Day. I knew the 14-year-old. He said to me one time, once I was in New York on a trip, I bought him a book of black history and brought it back. And once he said to me, you're on the wall at my school, you're hanging there on the wall. And he said, I wrote a paper on you. And I said, good, you know, did you tell him that we were friends? He said, yes. So his name was Antoine, and this is entitled Mother's Day. Saturday he walked the block. I should also add, he's a thin, scrawny little kid who was 14, but he looked like he was about 9 or 10. Saturday he walked the block, his 14-year-old back a rod, his head a tilt, his chin a jut, Antoine. His slightly lifted hand, his nod, acknowledgement, Antoine. Sunday, his small frame, his throat a grin agape, congealed in his fresh blood, the glory and the gore, the early sun a contradiction, Sunday's child, a gruesome gift, her Mother's Day. The neighbors wept, Antoine. His body was discovered on the back porch of his home. And I lived close enough that I heard the cries that morning, but I thought it was just a street argument or something. And my son awoke and said he heard it too. And then when we discovered what had happened, someone who lived in his house had cut his throat, a grown man, because Antoine, about 3 weeks earlier, had gotten involved as a runner or something for a drug group. And the interesting thing is the ladies on the block had been watching the kids, and three of us talked, and we agreed that this was what had happened. And one lady said she had talked to him, and the rest of us said we would talk to him, but, you know, we were too late. And the man, after he was arrested, said, well, Antoine owed him $35, and he knew he had it. That was her Mother's Day.
At Cornell, I had a white student, a sorority girl, who had a black little sister, who asked me if she could bring the little sister to meet me, and of course I said yes. She brought the child to the Africana Studies Research Center, and the child became an instant hit. You know, everybody liked her. The director took her upstairs and gave her historical comic books and stuff. And she was going to dinner with my student at the sorority house. And I said, shall we take my cosmetic bag and go in the ladies' room and sort of spruce you up? And we did that. We put on the lotion and brushed the hair down, straightened the dress. And my student told me later that she said, I'm going to act like a lady. And she did that day and that night. My student later reported that when she went to pick her up on another occasion to bring her to the center, the live-in man at her house, her mother's boyfriend, said she couldn't go. Last time she came back with an attitude. And that was what we were hoping for. But the student had told me enough for me to have decided that my child was in danger, this 11-year-old kid. I told the student to watch out for it, and I alerted some of the black middle-class women in the community, because I was leaving Ithaca and coming back to Indianapolis, to watch for Corrine, watch out for her. And I told my student what I felt, that she was in danger of assault from the man at home, who had moved her whole family to a remote place near Ithaca, where they were the only black family, and one maybe of two black families, kids in that school, and isolated from their neighbors. My student eventually was able to persuade Corrine to report sexual abuse to her school nurse. The case went to court, and the court decided that they couldn't prosecute the man on whatever evidence they had or did not have. And Corrine went back in the same home. And so this is for Corrine. It's called, Who Is It Will Not Bend. There is a law, but somehow it is always her word standing shamed against his sober protestations. She, an imprecise 11, dusty braids, haphazard sprouts, who knows her mother's head or could say why? So much to do, so little time or need to intervene on her behalf. Our Corrine of the bony limbs, the willful braids, the yard-wide smile, the mote in Mr. Tony's eye, and he, the guest who came 1 month for dinner, who forgot to leave, whose thoughtful eyes bought 4 young sisters, see, a portion of his Friday pay for rent, with bags of food and Jim Beam for their mama. Willistine, the best deal of her life to date, pleasured by the amber warmth, the sure oblivion droned one refrain, but that was only play and only love and only love and only play and did not hurt. He meant no harm. Now go on back in there, Corrine, and leave me alone. How classic this collusion, this partnering of weakness with the quiet steel of evil. We, the co-conspirators, consenting by our silence, refusing still to interrupt the chosen rhythms of our lives, rhythms of our lives. Although we mourn her smile, we do not need to know her name. We do not choose to know her name. We do not want to know. Who knows her mother's head or ours? And who will scream the words? Who will fight the fight? Who will guard the child? Who is it will not bend? Now, finally, we did write some love songs, and I'll read you one. It's called Celebration. I will bring you a whole person, and you will bring me a whole person. And we will have us twice as much of love and everything. I'd be bringing a whole heart, while it do have nicks and dents and scars. That only make me lay it down more careful-like. And you be bringing a whole heart, a little chipped and rusty and sometimes skip a beat, but still and all you bring in polish too and look like you intend to make it shine. And we be bringing, each of us, the music of ourselves to wrap the other in, for giving clarity soft is a choir's last lingering note of personal blend. I will bring you a whole person. You will bring me someone whole. And we be twice as strong. And we be twice as sure. And we will have us twice as much of love and everything. Thank you.